Good evening, everyone. My name is Thane Rosenbaum, and welcome to Touro Talks, where we showcase the richness and first-rate minds of Touro faculty and guest speakers. Tonight, our guest is Professor Henry Abramson, who is the Dean of Touro College. He's a historian and also an incredibly smart and interesting and charming guy. And we'll be discussing tonight a provocative topic, plagues and pandemics in Jewish history. Let's say hello to Henry. Henry, wave to our audience.
Hey, how are you?
Thanks for joining us for Touro Talks, Henry. So I don't know what your thoughts were, but when the producer of Touro Talks, Nahum Tversky, called me up and said, would you like to do one of these Touro Talks about plagues and pandemics in Jewish history? My first instinct was to say, Nahum, why would anyone care about that? I mean, what, pandemics? Who cares about plagues? This is modern society. It's not really germane to present lifestyle. You've been studying this as a historian for a while. I mean, is this the first time in your lifetime where the whole issue of pandemics and its connection to Jewish history actually became relevant?
I wish I could say that is true. But given that Jewish history spans so many millennia, there are many times when epidemic diseases intersects with Jewish history, and sometimes with very untoward consequences beyond the obvious mortality rate. And so right. I've had some encounters with before. I will say, however, that I have not spoken so much about it until this season.
So it's interesting when you think about the Jewish people, we were liberated, Jews were liberated because of plagues. The one in Egypt, of course, it didn't strike Jews, it struck the Egyptians. But I know that you have a very different sense of this, because when you hear the words plagues and pandemics, you immediately have a different association. You don't think about Jewish liberation, you think about blaming Jews for the plagues and the pandemics. Is that right? And can you give us the sort of historical connection to that?
I think, speaking from the Jewish perspectives, as I'm sure many of the members of our audience and yourself share, it's usually safer to be a little more pessimistic about things, right? Good for the Jews, bad for the Jews. I think the balance usually goes to bad for the Jews. I do tend to think about the consequences, not so much as the Jews as unwitting recipients of these various bacilli, but as, being negatively impacted by the social consequences. In fact, when you refer to the liberation from Egypt, I thought you were going to refer not to the Exodus account, which of course has the plagues occurring to the Egyptians, but there's a third century Egyptian priest named Manetho, right, who argued that no, we kicked the Jews out because they were diseased.
Yeah, I was definitely going to cover that.
Sorry to anticipate it.
We'll talk about that because that is an interesting anecdote. But what I think what you've described in some of your writings, Henry, is that especially during the Dark Ages, especially during the period of the Black Death, Jews were held responsible. But interestingly, not in the way, and we'll talk about this later, in terms of Jews as diseased, but as Jews that poison wells, it's not because they are, in the early days, it was not so much that they were carrying the disease, but I think they were required to confess that the Torah mandated that they poison non-Jews. And so that they were oftentimes, there were public burnings of Jews, public confessions of Jews, all related to the idea that they were not carriers, but that they were the ones that were spreading this. And interestingly, there was some idea that Jews were impervious to plagues, that they had some magical powers. So talk about that for a moment.
Well, most of the things you're describing are associated with the bubonic plague of the 14th century. And we should bear in mind that the understanding of what causes plague really didn't begin to resolve until the late 19th century. So for a long time, we had different kinds of theories. It was the miasma theory that talked about the fog and the stench of places that would carry and so on. In the case of the Black Death, there was a widely circulated rumor in Europe that Jews had somehow formed a confederation with lepers and were taking their diseased organs and placing it into the secret wellheads of Europe and poisoning the water and thus impacting the entire population. So that's really where that particular charge came from. Go ahead, Thane.
No, I was just going to say, but the imperviousness of it, the idea came from what? Because we know throughout history, there's been this fixation on Jewish magical powers, right? Small group of people, but in many ways, all powerful. And so was this part of that narrative, the idea that Jews somehow, among their many special powers, is that they were impervious to disease?
You definitely see some elements of that, but it's hard to really maintain it on a large scale when Jews were affected probably at a greater rate than non-Jews during the Black Death, primarily because they're urbanized. It was the urban penalty to live in close quarters with one another. But we should recall that for much of European history, Jews were actually considered somehow not quite human.
Right.
You know, tie that to the idea of the blood libel and the idea that Jewish men needed to drink blood in order to refresh the iron that they lost through menstruation. I mean, this is a period where people had really phantasmagoric kind of ideas about what Jews were and how they were different from other human beings.
Now, you have some medieval images you can show us to describe this.
Sure.
Let's take a look at a few.
Sure. You wanted to look at the medieval images or the ones related specifically to germs?
Whatever you think would be best for our audience.
Okay, let me just quickly pull that up. Sorry, I was not on the right page. Yeah, why don't we look at the contemporary things? So I just happen to have that convenient.
Okay, right. Let's take a look at that.
Yeah, what I am especially concerned with is the fact that the current crisis seems to be generating a new anti-Semitic trope that is, of course, you know, reliant on much older ones. If we just go back a little bit, here's an image from interwar France that portrays the Jew as a kind of a germ. The text reads, tuberculosis, syphilis, cancer, they're all curable, but we have to finish the greatest of all germs, the Jew. And you can see that rather, you know.
And so Henry, this is after the Dreyfus affair, but before the Holocaust, right?
Exactly, I think this is 1930, if I remember correctly.
Uh-huh.
And then this is a contemporary image here from America, referring to it not as the Chinese Jew, but the Chinese flu, but as the Jew flu. I don't know how successful that will be in messaging even the most right-wing elements of our population, but it definitely rhymes a little better.
And there's even a website to go look, right? There's a website. And is that where you pulled this from?
This is actually from the Anti-Defamation League. They do an amazing job at, you know, keeping their tabs on the state of the world in terms of hatred.
It's interesting. What's written within the image of the coronavirus: loot the treasury and martial law, right? Interesting that the associations with the things that seem to be, you know, anti-freedom are the things that Jews actually are imposing: martial law.
Yeah, I learned long ago. It's hard to, you can put yourself in mental pretzels trying to straighten out anti-Semitic ideology, but it's a very opportunistic kind of thought where they'll borrow whatever images or slogans seem to make sense at the time, even though they're mutually contradictory.
Like Jews. All right, so let's pull these off for a second. We'll come back to some of the other ones when we talk about Nazi Germany. So let's talk about something else. So let's go, I don't know how many hundreds of years we're past that. Tell us about the Sarifa mourning? Tell us about, is that how it's pronounced? Yeah. Sapira. I mean, many people in the audience will even know what that is, sure. Of course. But tell us the significance of that, because one of the things that I thought was interesting in some of the things I read of yours, that you said that the Mishnah actually defines what an epidemic is by way of mortality. It actually went to the trouble of giving you a kind of analysis of what this should actually look like. So clearly there was a time when the rabbis spent some time thinking about how this happens and what to do about it. In fact, I think you said that even the idea of social distancing was introduced in Mishnah, and even the idea of limiting the number of people that can go into a shul. I guess it's like a minyan plus 15 people tops. So talk about that. How did that come about? The rabbis just simply said, this is real and we have to figure out how we have to address this?
Yeah, I think it's very perceptive. We have to go a little bit further back before the Mishnah even, which was, you know, composed in the early 3rd century. You look at the Bible and there's a lot of discussion about plague and about contagion. And there's prescriptions in the book of Leviticus about, you know, if a person has a particular kind of growth, then you have to quarantine him. You have to check it out after 7 days, check it again after 14. If necessary, he has to leave the encampment. There's a lot of discussion about, you know, structures that may need to be demolished if they have an infestation. So even in the ancient world, the biblical world, there's this consciousness of the impact of plague. There's one in particular fascinating biblical passage, which is actually read every single weekday in synagogues, where King David receives a prophecy from Nathan the prophet that he's going to be punished by God, and he can choose one of three punishments. He can choose war, he can choose famine, or he can choose plague. And he ultimately decides that he prefers plague, because at least with a plague, it's entirely up to God. All those other things, people would say, well, as king, you're able to maneuver your way around it. You can use your own stores to avert famine. You can use your own army to protect yourself in war. But if we go to the second period that you're describing, the period of the Sephira, which is especially fascinating, yeah, because it talks about the rabbis perhaps obfuscating a historical reality. What do we know? The period arises, as we know it today, from the Bar Kokhba revolt, the second great failed rebellion against the Romans around the year 130.
So just so for those of us that don't know Jewish history that well, just to be clear, this is clearly just in terms of the line of rebellions. This is post-Masada. This is post-Maccabees. Just to be clear, for those of us that are new to this material, right? Just to give a sense of the timeline, right? Because there are, for someone like me, I'm not that well versed in Jewish history, I always think in terms of these various, epochal moments. Right. So this would have been after those, right? After
Masada. I have a great YouTube channel for you, by the way, if you want to catch up with some
to catch up on that. Okay. So after this revolt, yes, right?
So this is the Romans have managed to put down, to quell this revolt by the Jews. They've destroyed the temple, but the Jews have not been exiled from Israel. It's about 60 years later, kind of like the distance we are to the Holocaust, more or less. And there's a second revolt, and it's much more powerful, much more effective initially. But the Romans put all of their energies into it, and within a couple of years, they put down the population even more brutally. And in that connection, there is a kind of obscure Talmudic passage that says that 24,000 of Rabbi Akiva's students died of a plague during this period. And Rabbi Akiva was a very important rabbi who was a big supporter of Bar Kokhba, the leader of the rebellion.
Oh, but this was this actually in coincident with the uprising, there was a plague happening that took the lives of 24,000 students.
That is, if you read the Talmud at face value, exactly.
Because you know, that sounds like, wow, that's a lot. That's right. That's like 9/11 and something else on top.
College age men and things like that. Why only them? Why not regular people?
Yeah, right? Exactly. 24,000 students.
And by the way, up until today, Jews still observe a period of semi-mourning,
right,
because of those deaths.
And the point you make on that is that only shows you how important we take plagues, that we've actually incorporated that in terms of rituals and practice. Anyway, go ahead.
Exactly. The problem is that if you look at another very important medieval source, one of the greatest sources we have explaining the Talmud, this is the famous letter of Rav Shvira Gaon. He does not use the word plague to describe the deaths of the 24,000 students. He uses the term persecution, which seems to imply and is entirely consistent with the Roman reaction to the rebellion. If we imagine that Rabbi Akiva, a big supporter of Bar Kokhba, had all of his students fighting against the Romans.
Yeah.
If the Romans put down that revolt, then the plague really was the Romans itself, not actually a contagion. The term they used for plague is probably, would translate today as diphtheria.
Yeah.
It may have been in itself kind of like a sort of Aesopian language, kind of a hidden term to try and perhaps avoid undue attention from Christian authorities. But that's the first really big post-biblical possible plague that we have. Then we have other sources about smaller plagues and era of Justinian and so on. But the massive one that we referred to already is the Black Death in the 14th century. But if I can jump ahead to your social distancing for a second.
Yeah.
Okay, so social distancing.
Now, I'm trying to remember in your writings, was that related to cholera or was that?
Social distancing was related to cholera, right.
Okay.
One of the great prevalent illnesses of the period, which of course is related to a tainted water supply. But
right.
That wasn't understood until the 19th century as well.
But wait, are you saying that Jewish rabbis imposed social distancing in connection with cholera before even government, but certainly there was no World Health Organization, right? But I'm saying the governments themselves were not actually requiring social distancing. It was rabbis that were requiring.
Well, what you're saying now is perhaps it's alluding to the most important thing I would like to say in this particular talk. Maybe we'll get back to it again. But one of the things I haven't written very much about, and I'm tempted to write something about now because of the unique political social moment we're in here in this country. There's a very, very powerful idea that runs throughout rabbinic thought, which is this phrase, chamira sekanta mi isura, translation, danger is more stringent than prohibition, than ritual prohibition, which means if you have on the one hand a danger to someone's life, and on the other hand, the observance of the Sabbath, you forget about the Sabbath. You've got to preserve the human life. And there are a whole range of examples of this where the rabbis say, oh, we're not allowed to do this. We're not allowed to eat this. We're not allowed to say this. Oh, but wait a second. If it's a danger to life, if it's a danger to health, you have to say it, you have to eat it, you have to do it. And the Talmud and the Code of Jewish Law describes all kinds of practices which they advocate just so long as the prevalent medical opinion says this is recommended. So I think this is a very pragmatic approach to illness, which is unfortunately so hard to understand in our society where people won't wear masks, for example. I
right.
find it hard to understand it. I would love to just drill this idea home that when it comes to an idea of physical health, that's so much more important than all these other political ideas and religious ideas and so on. And the rabbis would absolutely agree. That's why I think maybe so many Jewish mothers like to have a doctor first and then maybe a rabbi later. Shall I answer your question about social distancing?
Yeah, I want to understand that.
So I think with this kind of approach, that is to consider public health more important than a religious principle, I think the rabbis cast about for whatever seemed to be working. So even in the Talmud, you've got some social distancing strategies mentioned, but I don't get the sense that they really are aware of, let's say, germ theory of disease. They say when there's a plague, you know, be careful where you walk, which seems to imply don't walk where it's very crowded and so on. And when a plague starts, it's better for you to leave town. You know, when the plague, because you don't want to be around so many people. When a plague is ending, that's not when you want to leave town. That's when you want to stay in town.
You're saying they understood the concept of distancing.
Right. When it becomes actually a kind of like a written rule that we find in the 19th century, or late 18th century, excuse me, when the smallpox vaccines were beginning to circulate and people were understanding a lot more about this, and the great Rabbi Akiva Eiger formally said that there should be a limit on the number of people in synagogue and that the secular police may be involved to make sure that social distancing is maintained.
And wow.
In fact, one fascinating, not so well-known thing is that during the cholera epidemics of the 1830s in particular, I believe it may be 1860s, it was Rabbi Akiva Eiger who initiated the practice of having multiple people recite Kaddish at the same time. Before then, the prayer for the dead would only be read by one person at a time, which meant that if there were multiple mourners, they had to take turns. But in Rabbi Akiva's age, because of the epidemic, there was so much mortality that he simply said, you know what, we're all going to say it in unison. And that has, unfortunately, in a sense, become the prevalent custom today.
I read that, but I still didn't quite understand why. Was it for pragmatic reasons, because this gets us more, you know, that we have more Kaddish, we get to say more, cover more death, or is it about solidarity? that this is something that we can do for social cohesion in the presence of such magnitude of loss, that we come together as a community. I'm just saying that there are two ways of looking at it. We get to multiply the mourning, you know, the Kaddish, which is good because we have extra bodies that we have to deal with. But on top of that, this is a very special time of loss, so we should join together for this purpose. Well, is it both of those?
You know, you're saying something very profound, I think. It's really both reasons, I think, but I never thought about the second. The first reason is that, you know, it's almost right, actually next week is the Yahrzeit, the anniversary of my father's own passing. And, you know, it takes months building up to that. And you have that one day to say Kaddish. And, you know, I would hate to lose it because someone has precedence over me, priority over me.
Yeah.
So on the one hand, it's allowing me to express my own grief publicly. But secondly, you're absolutely right. To be able to say it in solidarity with others, to feel that I am not alone in my pain and my grief. That's brilliant.
Oh, well, thank you. Stumbled into that one there, Henry. So you mentioned a moment ago about it, and I want to just briefly mention, because it's obviously something you're interested in. I thought it was interesting. The Egyptian priest, which was like 2,300 years, I guess, after the Exodus itself, or was it 2,300 years ago? I can't remember what that number was. Yeah. But you said, when you said a moment ago, well, he told a completely revisionist history of the Exodus, and he said, Exodus, the hell with that. It had nothing to do with Exodus. It was called exile, expulsion.
Exodus, Shmexodus.
Yeah, Exodus, Shmexodus. We got rid of those Jews because they were contagions. So was that the first time in recorded history that, because you said there were two periods. One, you said in the Dark Ages, Middle Ages, it was superpowers of Jews, and that they were impervious. But, you know, the Egyptian priest actually had a very different spin, and actually a very, if you think about it, a pernicious retelling. I mean, really ugly, right? It's a really ugly thing. No, this isn't about signs and wonders. This is about you people being gross. You know, you're just gross, and we have to get rid of you. Forget the sign, none of that. We just needed to get out of Egypt. I'm wondering, so was that the first time that was introduced the idea of Jews as carriers?
I believe that is the case. I can't think of anything earlier that would have driven home the same message. I would not overemphasize the impervious aspect of it to it. There are definitely some tropes of that, but I wouldn't say it is the majority. But the idea of Jews of somehow being carriers of disease and of spreaders of disease, definitely. It's probably one of the earliest calumnies that the Jews endured, especially after the Bible.
I read somewhere where you wrote, Henry, I love this. I don't know how much you said about it, but I loved it. I'm neither a cat nor a dog person. I'm not a pets person, although my children wish I owned a dog right now. But you said something, I think you said, well, Jews historically were not dog owners. They were cat owners. And so therefore there was some idea that cats got rid of rodents, and rodents, of course, were the carriers. And so that there was some way of thinking about how Jews were able to through household pets, were able, despite, as you said, they're urban dwellers, there's no social distancing because everyone, you know, is living in an Eldridge Street apartment tenement, 15 people in an apartment in a tenement. How can you possibly not get the same sickness that all your brothers and sisters had? Yeah. So what was that idea about cats and dogs?
To clarify, it's, I think it's wishful thinking on behalf of kind of, you know, in the 19th century, when Jewish historians really started working and started writing in vernacular languages, there was a desire historiographically to try to make the Jews appear, you know, more heroic than they may have been. And one of the arguments which was advanced without too much data was the idea that the Jews somehow dodged the Black Death. And there's no support for that. And in fact, it seems to be the opposite because the urban penalty. But among the theories that was used to advance something which was in itself a false supposition was the idea that because Jews are generally afraid of dogs, that in itself is a questionable statement, but there are some passages in the Talmud that say it's forbidden to own a mean dog and things like that. And there are passages that praise cats. We can learn a lot about their behavior, for example. So that's where that particular facing the rodent idea. But we do have some elements that might have some merits. Like, for example, Jews typically in the Middle Ages, 14th century, would bathe at least once a week, which doesn't quite hit our standards today. But that was a good sight better than most non-Jews in the 14th century.
But what about hand washing? You know, now we're told, right, for the last 4 months, people have become Olympian in their capacity to wash hands, right? Hot water, get in between the fingers. You know, I understand that, you know, before one eats challah, you know, they wash. No one's ever said to me, here's your soap bar. Right. They don't actually, I don't know enough of whether the rabbi said, well, you know, there's a lot of reasons why we do it. But one reason we do it is because it prevents disease. Is there some evidence that rabbis were thinking that too?
Not quite disease, but possibly infestation. The reason that we wash our hands before eating bread, which as you point out correctly, is without soap. So you don't get much of the benefit of killing the virus.
Although they might have thought it didn't matter, right? They might have thought water alone.
Yeah. Learned people back then would have known the reason that people wash today is because the Kohanim in the temple had to wash before dealing with the sacrifices. Worrying that the Kohanim would be lazy about washing, the rabbi said, you know what, everybody wash.
Okay?
Everybody wash. So technically speaking, washing is sort of like we've all taken it on in order to reinforce Kohanim's bad behavior. Now, why would Kohanim have to wash? There's a lot of discussion in the Talmud about washing when you handle valuable manuscripts. If your hands are not washed properly and you put the manuscripts back in the closet, and then mice will come and pick up the residue of whatever you've eaten, they'll ruin the manuscripts. And so there's a lot of discussion there about the importance of cleanliness, not so much for food, but for something we really care about, books.
Right. Let's take a look at two illustrations of Nazi era imagery. Do you have anything like that?
And then we'll
move on to an entirely different topic.
So let's see, I think I have some in the, let's go back a little bit. This is just a lecture I'm giving for a course this fall in the summer.
Uh-huh.
So here we go. This is from Poland, and it is associating Jews with fleas that are believed to carry typhus.
And wow.
The image is obviously very evocative. Here is another one. This is actually before the war, and this is my favorite. It's kind of like a louse, and you can see that the louse, my favorite part is it has a dollar sign in one eye and a hammer and sickle in the other, right?
So, oh, wow.
Capitalism and communism.
Wow. And a very large nose.
Yeah. Vermin is popular, you know, like spiders and so on. Mushrooms as well, because mushrooms, you know, grow in places of decay and things like that. And also, actually, this is not a mushroom. This is a gift pilz, a toadstool, a poison mushroom. The idea being that just like, you know, you have to be an expert to tell the difference between a toadstool and a mushroom, you also have to be an expert to tell the difference between a Jew and a non-Jew.
Interesting.
By the way, a children's book.
Well, we knew near Nazi Germany that they were obsessed with, first of all, in the camps, they used the word delousing, right? They were obsessed with typhus in Jews. Mm-hmm. There were outbreaks in ghettos, right? In the Jewish ghettos.
So guaranteed if you squeeze people in like that.
That's right. I mean, the very point that you said at the outset about the urban dweller, the ultimate experience of that is the crowding of the ghettos themselves.
Absolutely.
So self-fulfilling prophecy. You claim Jews are the carriers of germs, and then you put them in a situation where, of course, they're going to be contagious. Let's move on to another area that I think our audience would be interested in. We've set up the sort of historical connection between Jewish history and pandemics, but we're now living in a time that we're trying to say, how does one maintain the observance, the rituals, the practice of Jewish life in the context of where we're faced? Jews apparently have always had to deal with this, right? If there was a history of this, both the prejudice associated with pandemics and the experience of Jews being actually sick. Mm-hmm. You pointed out before the special rules that apply when a person is sick. But I think people are interested, curious about, well, we're living in an age of pandemics, But what makes this era differently is Zoom and the internet, virtual synagogues. Mm-hmm. And the question here that I want to talk about is, on the one hand, this is the good fortune of the internet. On the other hand, it gives you the limitations of the technology. Is Jewish practice ritual, does it have a social dimension? Does it require human interaction? Or can it be done, you know, davening alone? There was that book a number of years ago, 20 years ago, by Putnam, Bowling Alone, very famous book, and it talked about the lack of civic engagement. And so therefore people now aren't in bowling leagues, they bowl alone. And so I guess you could make the same argument. What's the implications of davening alone? How important is it to study Torah next to people, studying right there with you? How important is it to walk out of shtiebels with people and talk about it? I think I read somewhere where you wrote, and we'll talk about this later when we talk about Jewish education. I love that you said, well, you know, going away to college also includes sports, right? It includes late night discussions about books that you've read. That's part of what it means to go to college. And Zoom doesn't really offer that unless you set that up. So tell us what your thinking is about, have we adapted well? Do we understand the long-term implications of this? What do you suggest for Jewish communities around the world?
Oh my gosh, you're asking me a question like I really know the answer. Those are brilliant questions and I struggle with them. I am, however, a historian, so almost everything I do is like backwards. I like to deal with the past, with things that already happened, schon vergangen. You're asking in the prophecy department down the street.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, I am deeply engaged with these questions, and I have a few maybe observations. I would say the Jewish people are incredibly resilient, very, very resilient. We will find ways to survive under incredible pressures. This is nothing compared to the pressures that, you know, the Holocaust generation went through, to what, you know, Jews in Soviet Union went through. So we will find ways to get through this.
And also, I read somewhere that you reminded me, thanks to reading Henry Abramson, was reminded about the conversos during that there's a long history of clandestine shuls.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, Jews in hiding, actually still observing, no Zoom, but figuring out a way to make it work. We've heard of stories in the death camps, right? Yeah. We've heard, you know, one of those great, you know, the big dramatic story, the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, took place during Pesach. And so Jews, while they were, you know, searching for the Afikoman, were also shooting Nazis, you know, and this is, I'm not just exaggerating, that's true, that this was all happening simultaneous.
Jews are incredibly resilient, but we are wounded and we are shaped, and often we are shaped negatively. It's hard, for example, looking at the crypto Jews and the Inquisition. You know, the Jewish people took a phenomenal blow in those, the 100 years leading up to the expulsion and then beyond. And, you know, it's the fact that we are an orphan generation, that we don't know what it was like back then, that we can't contemplate how bad it is now. So we will definitely take a hit with this. We think about how we take a hit. So when it comes to your most important question about, you know, how does one do Judaism? One can certainly daven alone. My wife, for example, who is an awesome davener, she actually really prefers davening alone. You know, she prefers the focus, the quiet, and she can daven as long as she wants. She doesn't have to overhear other people talking. You know, davening, connection to God, it's possible anywhere. What is special about shul that we get that we don't get from Zoom? I find now that my shul is slowly reassembling with social distancing, what I miss terribly is Kiddush. You know, like when I go to shul regularly and I say my regular prayers, which I know almost by heart, and then at the end, we all just kind of say, well, that's it. Not even a cracker and a piece of herring. And it's not that I'm there for the cracker or the piece of herring. It's a small bit of fellowship that brings us together as a community. We exert ourselves, we spiritually exercise ourselves in the prayer, and then you need a little bit of like kind of schwitz after exercise to just schmooze a little bit. And that's lacking. And how long can we go without that? You know, we're a very gregarious people by nature, by culture. I think that has long-term effects, especially for the youth who don't have that socialization. I also wonder one more detail, a brilliant journalist named Shira Hanau, an up-and-coming journalist who writes for JTA, she published something today. It was just very, very thought-provoking about how since so much of synagogue life is now online, why should we listen to our local, maybe somewhat Nebuchadnezzar Rebbe? Maybe we should like invest our funds in a big name rabbi, you know, like a Rabbi Sachs or something. And have it, because it's just my Zoom screen, right? The idea of having a personal relationship with a real human being that you can give a hug to, shake hands with, you know, schmooze over herring with, that's got value. But if I can't have that, might as well go for the stars. And that can only lead to greater alienation. That can only create more centrifugal forces in the Jewish people, where we have our superstar rabbis, but we don't have our local neighborhood rabbis. And I think it would be a huge loss for our communities if we move in that direction.
So it's so interesting, you know, it makes one remind, it's a very crass analogy, yeah. Henry, but you know, what people feared about Amazon, right? We will lose the mom and pop store, right? Yeah. Right, we will lose that sense of engagement. I go into the store. By the way, I thought you were gonna say another K word. You said kiddish. I read you had a better K word in my view. You said the word kibitzing. Uh-huh. I read another Henry Abramson article where you said, hey, you know, kibitzing is part of what it means to be part of the Jewish communal experience. And when you walk out of shul, that's, you know, yeah, you want your herring and the kiddush, but there's also just the actual, what you said, schmoozing. The kibitzing is a part, you said, you know, gregarious people. That can't be done alone.
Yes. Absolutely.
You know, that
can't be done well on Zoom either.
I was just going to say, it's not even done as much as I'm enjoying this with you. You and I know we do better if I see you,
for sure.
Right? I mean, we just do better. It'd be more fun. It's a great way to do it. It's simpler. It's efficient. But we know that in the same way that people worry about the decline of the brick and mortar store, of the alienation, the destruction of neighborhoods, mm-hmm. you know, because of, you know,
the commoditization of it.
Yeah, right. The commoditization, right. In terms of the giant superstore, that means that you don't have the small stores out there, that this has got to be true of rabbis. It has to be true of everything, not just rabbis, right? It has to be true of everyone who plays a role. I, from my shul, I'm used to, you know, the people that greet me at the door have been there for 25 years. You know, the ushers, I've seen them for 25 years. They've seen all my kids grow up. That's part of the experience of going to shul for me.
It's a part of the feeling of being part of a kahila.
Yeah, and it's hard to know whether Zoom creates that sense of the communal experience with full respect and acknowledgement that it creates enormous efficiencies, especially in an epidemic. So would you say that one of the things that we have to accept is that we may have to do it this way, but we can't lose sight of the fact that Jewish practice, Jewish observance is really a communal experience. Walking to shul is part of going to shul. That's what it means. There was something, I'm gonna talk about this in a moment, we're gonna talk about the education experience. Did you say, what was the word you used? Something like, there's a travel benefit or something?
Yeah,
what did you say?
Halicha, skar halicha. I don't know.
What does that mean?
It means the reward of travel.
Yeah.
The reward of schlepping benefit. So if right. you live further away from synagogue, you actually earn, with your pedometer, you earn more points in heaven, so to speak.
Well, that was actually one of the things.
That's traveling.
Right, you're saying you get more yichus, more credit for the effort that it took to get there. It reminded me of something else I read that you wrote, what you said, let us not forget that this is what suburbia did to Jewish life. Mm. It introduced the idea of driving to shul, which there was never a need to do this if you lived on the Lower East Side. It only became something if you moved to Long Island and you live 10 miles away from your shul. And that, of course, opened up the opportunities for, you know, more of exposure to the outside world and assimilation and a degrading of the ritualization of Jewish life.
I think the actual parallel is not so much the suburbanization, but specifically giving the stamp of approval to driving on the Sabbath. As soon as you say it's okay to drive on the Sabbath, that means, oh, I can live further away and I'll still drive to shul. But the next generation, maybe the generation after, isn't going to bother driving to shul at all.
Right. You're saying it opens, right? It opens a door.
I don't have to show up to the community to daven together. I'll just zoom in. Who knows how long we will zoom in, and who knows if our children will zoom in.
Yeah.
So there's something you have to, this is something that I'm working on a separate book that I hope to finish by October.
I look forward to that.
Thank you. It's on the Hasidic thought of Rabbi Kolonimus Kama Shapira, also known as the Rebbe of the Warsaw Ghetto. And he has a very strong, amazingly for the 1930s, postmodern approach to Judaism, in which he says, essentially, I'm not going to try and walk you through the arguments to believe in God. I want you to taste the cholent. I want you to feel what it's like. Immerse yourself in the sensation, the immediacy of feeling what it is to be Jewish. And I'm sorry, although I'm enjoying this conversation very much, if I reach out and touch your Shane upon him, all I touch is my screen, right?
Yeah.
It's not the same thing.
So, yeah. We're missing the cholent.
Exactly.
Missing the cholent. You know, on the other hand, I know there were people who would argue if I lived in Alaska, the Zoom world allowed me to participate in Jewish life in ways that I would have never had an opportunity to do. Yes, it's great if you live in disparate communities. Yeah. But I think that what you are saying is that overall, it is a degrading invariably of not Torah studying, walking, sitting next to people. I mean, I'm thinking about things that I'm afraid people won't do anymore.
Yeah. Know that they're missing it.
That's packed shtiebels. Shtiebels that are packed. Also, so many yeshivas and shtiebels, there's like an underground element, basements, no air ventilation. This is what people are obsessed with now, right? They're obsessed. I would never go underground now. I wouldn't go into a subway and I wouldn't study, you know, and you can imagine how, you know, that's something they will fear. I would study the Torah, but not downstairs, right? I don't want to go there. Can we go in upstairs and open all the windows? Things that we're going to have to figure out a way to accommodate, because people now have an inherent fear of this sort of the possibility of contamination. I also think about what Pesach this year did to people. It was a real blow.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, really a blow. It happened right at the same time. You know, the cause of the effect that COVID has had on Jewish life. And if you know that this is the last week for the Jewish week in New York City, they're closing down as a paper. This is all related to COVID-19. Among other things, I know this is going to sound silly, advertisement for matzah, Pesach in Miami Beach, all of those, you know, big revenue issues disappeared. You know, we keep forgetting the positive. Also, elderly. We became very afraid. Elderly were the most vulnerable. We couldn't possibly have a Seder with Zeta. How could we have a Zeta? You can't possibly come. He'll get sick. This was a really merciless, you know, disease for Jews.
Yeah.
Because it really affected us. I think in the isolation of mourners that lost family, right? How we've seen time and time again. Here's a Zoom if you want to come to my father's funeral. Here's how you can do it. Nobody wanted that. Nobody, you know, felt that they were participating in anything meaningful. You're the dean of Touro College in Brooklyn. Let's talk about school.
But can I pause for 1 second and add one thought to before?
Yeah, please do.
So there's no question that the dangers of this very powerful tool are quite real and that we have to think carefully about them. But it's also true that it's offered us a reset of a lot of important things. One of my students at Touro, so it's a good segue,
good.
She wrote a beautiful article recently about how she had a Zoom wedding. And just talk about how beautiful it was. Suddenly, you know, these weddings, which have become bloated and sometimes grotesque display of wealth, it had to be a very small shtetl-like affair with and a few people standing around it. And she said it was so beautiful. And she wrote a fantastic article. It's very well reviewed. Her name is Ms. Schechter. And these are the kinds of things where you know, maybe we'll get a reset out of this as yeah. well, that we can reevaluate what we want to preserve and how to preserve it best.
Well, so, I read that you said, Henry, somewhere that if you look at Jewish history, the one thing that's true is that even after the most calamitous catastrophes, Jews ended up adapting to the new reality. They found a way to make it work. And, you know, and maybe you're saying, I love the word reset, that not only make it work in some ways, but in the adapting, finding new meaning or being reminded of its true essence,
yeah.
which gets lost. You know, I was, I don't want to spend a lot of time thinking about this, but I could not think about it when you mentioned about the wedding, because I thought, you know, New Yorkers think of the COVID virus when they think, well, where did it start? Well, there was a Jewish lawyer that lived in New Rochelle, right? And that idea, you know, that idea that this, the ground zero was a shul and a wedding yeah. in New Rochelle, that this became early on, those were where the numbers were. People have forgotten this, right? But it was originally, oh, it's Westchester. It's not New York. It's not Queens. It's just Westchester. And it had that unfortunate quality, which only fed into some of the images that you showed, that this is, you know, it's, I remember I wrote about this recently, some, you know, Southern pastor who wrote, this is a disease that emanated from the synagogues, right? And no doubt the New Rochelle wedding was what was in his mind. So Dean Abramson, tell us about the pandemic and what we can expect for students going back. I every university is trying to figure it out. We've already done an event on this, and we're still willing to do more events on what it's going to look like. But I'm more interested in talking to you not about the logistics, but its value, right? Can we claim, yes, you can get a degree, but can, yes, you can learn. But can you learn with the same, you know, what is it, Yiddish tom, right? The sense of it, the taste, will you get the same experience? Yes, you have a bit bachelor's, but is it the same bachelor's? There's a story that I want you to just tell the audience that I read somewhere that you wrote about how you were in graduate school in Toronto and you had a mentor and you described how every morning you would hang out at a donut shop. So you saw he would walk by, I guess it was cold. So you were waiting in the donut shop and then you would walk him through the park, right? And that you, so much of the experience of you learning was walking your professor through the park after you've, you know, you spotted him in the donut shop. So, I mean, obviously you've been thinking about this since you were a graduate student, that this is a part of what it means to learn.
Oh my gosh, so much useful, great questions, really fascinating. I'll answer the first. And I think with regards to Touro College, I'm senior enough in management that I get to participate in these calls that we have, these big Zoom calls twice a week where we try to figure our way through this confusion. And I'm really proud to be with such an amazing team of academic, very thoughtful leaders. And I think what has been best about the way we've navigated this crisis is that after tussling with it for some time, we came up with three core values. And once we identified those three values, everything else basically falls into place. They are, one, to protect our community, but our first value, like that idea about the Talmud of it's more serious yeah. to observe health. And that's the first value, make sure that everyone is safe. And we won't do anything that compromises that first value. The second is, of course, we're an educational institution, so it's educate. And that means we've got to look at the tools we have, whether it's Zoom, whether it's social distance classes and so on, and we're going to use those to the best of our ability to give our students the highest quality education. And the third thing is adapt. You know, it's not impossible, God forbid, that the virus could make its way back up north and we'll have to change again. So all of our systems have to have that kind of resilience and the ability to snap into an online version. And I think we've done a lot of great things. In terms of your second question about the Yiddish Atam, the Jewish taste.
Yeah.
It's in the people. It's in the people, including the non-Jews, by the way, if you know that famous Lenny Bruce skit where if you're from Montana, I don't care how Jewish you are, you're not Jewish. If you're Bronx, you can be Italian, you're Jewish, right? But the people that we have in our institution are so focused on the values in our mission statement, which are not only Jewish, but on my campus in particular, we tend to be, you know, right in the heart of Brooklyn. We're very much in tune with that. And I think that whatever Yiddish atam we're going to give in the middle of this crisis is a result of the incredible talent and dedication of our faculty and staff that daily amazes me. To return to your last question, which is about mentorship. Yeah, one of the things I learned when I was in yeshiva that was more or less the same time I was in graduate school was that, you know, there's a great passage in the Talmud which talks about levels of rabbinic wisdom. And it's a dialogue. And one rabbi says to another rabbi, Yore, does he know how to issue prohibitions? And the other rabbi says, Yore. So that became the first level. It's called Yore, Yore. It means he knows how to make prohibitions. Then the next question he asks is Yadin. Is he able to judge, like with monetary disputes? And he says, Yadin. Yeah, he could do that too. So that's next level, Yadin, Yadin. The third level, which is called Matir Bechoros, which I won't go into detail, it has to do with a very ineffable thing, which you do not find the same way in Western education, of Shimush Talmidei Chachamim, of mentorship. Has he been an apprentice? Has he been a disciple? And to whom? And what? How did that work? And so early on in yeshiva, like for example, one of my chevrusas, he had a very, very high level position because he used to take the Rosh Yeshiva's dry cleaning to the cleaners. That was like a learning stage. In my yeshiva, we used to give the jobs of cleaning the floors to the boys who were in the highest levels, not the introductory levels, the highest levels. It was considered a kind of a spiritual work that was about contributing to the community and observing in close detail the rabbis at close quarters. So with regards Zoom, we have kind of eliminated a lot of the gaps between learning sessions, which are so valuable for learning in themselves. Like luckily before we had this little talk we're having now, we had 15 minutes where we checked the lighting and things like that. And yeah, that's where I really learned a lot about you. That's where I felt like I got to know you much more than even what we're doing now for 60 minutes. And that's what we're in danger of losing with our technology. One of the things Zoom meetings is they start smack right on time, right? Everybody shows up within 30 seconds and you don't have that kind of jostling and finding your seat and getting your coffee and stuff that is so valuable.
Dean Abramson, what if we simply impose the experience of Thane and Henry talking about lighting? You know, that we have to add extra time before and after, because that's how you learn stuff. It's the equivalent of cleaning the floor, we somehow are Zooming together while we're doing a chore, a task, and we're sort of watching each other do it and we're talking through it. Look, it sounds really antisocial, right? It doesn't sound very appealing, but remember, you know, it's interesting. It's like you get what you wish for. We have been complaining about this anyway, Jews and non-Jews, that we've been living in a social media, Facebook, online world.
Right.
Everyone is glued to their phone. Everyone's glued to the internet. There's no face-to-face. There's no people calling each other on the phone. Nobody's saying, hey, you want to take a walk? So we've been saying this, you know, it's almost as if this is, you know, a punishment. That, you know, we're being forced to say, well, what if it's too much? Because now we all think it's too much and we feel too much of a sense of isolation. And many, I love the word you used before about reset. This is a different way to reset. It's forcing us to rethink, you know what, we maybe took it too far. I really miss those moments where I had the freedom to go and meet Henry.
That is beautiful. And we have to go on a technology fast.
Yes, I love that. That's beautiful.
At least once a week. I would suggest Friday sundown until Saturday stars come out. It's a great time for this technology fast where you have to connect with your spouse and your family and your community. It's just so hard under COVID circumstances. And God forbid if a person is living alone, it's tremendously isolating.
Do you think you said before that you really enjoy spending time with the senior people at Touro, the leadership team that you're a member of? And you see the hard work that comes to make these decisions. Do you think that this is eventually going to be part of the choreography of student life over the next year, which is that we have to figure out ways for students to go on walks with each other 6 feet apart, right? Sure. That we have to find ways to actually incorporate what we're saying, that to create the actual social experience as opposed to the mythical, fictional social experience of social media, which was never, it was more about the network. It was not about the socialization. You know, we really need socialization.
You're actually channeling what the provost has been saying quite a bit lately, saying that, okay, now that we're working out some of the basics of this, we've figured out how to get all the faculty aligned, students online, how do we create that kind of social glue that comes about through the walks in the park? And we've tried a few experiments. The idea you had about a mandatory get together and talk about the lighting, I've experimented with myself and it doesn't seem to really work. It seems kind of, you know, forced. But yeah, there have been cyber cafes on some of our campuses where instructors have tried to set up drop-in hours where students can hang out online, and that seems to be better. I noticed from reading the Times, I've never actually participated in one, but people have like Zoom happy hours.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if we can do those kinds of things. Do people actually go to these Zoom happy hours?
I have to tell you, Henry, I know we both have a Miami connection. Yeah. My high school friends from Miami, we don't do it anymore, but we did it for the first 2 months. On Sundays at 5, we did this happy hour. And I was the one of two New Yorkers. Everyone else was somewhere around South Florida. But 15 people every Sunday, it was actually quite civilized and necessary. You know, it was very necessary that we would all speak to each other. And I will say this, we wouldn't have done it without this.
So
this forced, these were high school friends who, you know, it's been over 40 years. And this forced us to do something we would have never done.
Why doesn't it continue?
I don't know why. I wish it did. Believe me, I loved it. It stopped a few weeks ago, but it was necessary. It was restorative. It was essentially human, and it offered something that truly didn't happen before. Let's take a question from our audience from somewhere. Let's see. How about I'm not sure. Let's try this one. This one is a question. I think it's a question. From Nathan Reisel. An early anti-Semitic claim was that the Jews kept the Sabbath because of a disease they contracted from Egyptian slavery that weakened them. Have you ever heard of that?
Yes, absolutely I have. And I'm just curious, is that the famous Rabbi Nathan Reisel, who's a Touro alumnus? Send in a quick Q&A so I can see whether that's you, Rabbi Reisel. It's nice to see your name. And if not, I'm sure you're a very nice person. So this is actually a charge that came out of the Greco-Roman period. The Greeks and the Romans were fascinated and obsessed to a certain degree with the Jews because they really respected antiquity, and the Jews were a very old people, so they wanted to understand what makes their culture tick. Uh-huh. One of the things that they really could not get was the fact that we took off one day in seven, which was like incredible by ancient standards, where most people, free men, not talking about slaves who would hardly get anything off, but free men would get off, the emperor's birthday, the vernal equinox, things like that, maybe a few days a year. Jews were taking off one day in seven. So one of the arguments was, well, it must be that they are incapable of working 7 days a week. They must be somehow debilitated by a disease. Ah, what about that Manetho guy who says they got it in Egypt? That must be what it is. So it's a misanthropic argument that comes from the Greeks and Romans.
Henry, you are absolutely a Touro treasure. Really enjoyed this. I think the audience really got a chance to know you and hear you and learn from you. This is a perfect example of what Touro Talks is about. And we're so happy to have been able to showcase you because we're so proud of you. For the audience, we're going to continue Touro Talks. As Henry has just pointed out, specifically in large part because we know we're all going through this crisis. And this is something that Touro can do as a public service to its community to both connect you to Touro and introduce you to Touro and to provide meaningful content while you're all home. This was a breezy hour with Dean Abramson, and we all walked away smarter because of that. So this is Thane Rosenbaum for Touro Talks. Keep joining us again, and we'll see you next time. Good night, Henry.
Good night, Thane. It was great speaking with you.